that's what you are. Unforgettable, though near or far, like a song of love that clings to me, how the thought of you does things to me. Never before has someone been more unforgettable in every way. And forevermore, that's how you'll stay. That's why, darling, it's incredible that someone so unforgettable thinks that I am unforgettable too.
Spawaj mi, spawaj Ancice, spawaj mi, spawaj Ancice, spawaj mi, spawaj Ancice, na krilu swoje majczyce. Tulipan Jorgowan, to su cvita dva, molilo se dvoje mladik odla goluba. Tulipan Jorgovan, to su cvita dva, molilo se dvoje mladik odla goluba. Tvoja će majka spavati, tvoja će majka spavati, tvoja će majka spavati, a mi ćemo se ljubiti. Tulipan Jorgovan, to su cvita dva, molilo se dvoje mladih kod dva goluba. Tulipan Jorgovan, to su cvita dva, molilo se dvoje mladih kod dva goluba. Tvoja crna oka dva, ta tvoja crna oka dva, ta tvoja crna oka dva, moje su srce zanjela. Tulipan Jorgovan, to su cvita dva, molilo se dvoje mladih kod dva goluba. Tulipan Jorgovan, to su cvita dva, molilo se dvoje mladih kod dva goluba.
Your life. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you very much for being here to celebrate the life of Thomas Richard Vukovich. I'd like to ask Bill Stankovic to come up and say a few words about my father.
It's a very sad occasion, and I reminisce. I think it was in the 80s when my family went up to bury Mr. Thomas Vukovich Sr., and my father delivered a eulogy at the grave. Thomas and I knew each other as children when my family moved from Hamilton to Shoemaker, Ontario, which among the Croatian community is known as Little Zagreb. And I guess we spent 2-3 years there, and then we moved back to Ontario when my dad moved from a mining job to a machine operator at Dominion Glass and Westinghouse eventually, after he learned the language and so on. I have a little crib sheet here because I had to look up a word, because my nickname for Thomas was Magnanimous Thomas. And as last night of all time, the kids asked me to say something in Croatian. Now, even though it's my first tongue, I'm a little rusty in it, but I will make an effort later. So magnanimous, we understand it, but in Croatian it has a much deeper, much more meaningful meaning. And it means, in Croatian it's veliko dušan. Now, simply translated, veliko means large or big. Dušan is like a soul. However, the kind of undertone is veliko means with great open heart, soul. It's much more, in Croatian, it has these words that are that mean much more than what they literally translate into. In any event, I'm go to my crib sheet here. After we moved back to Hamilton, I went to school there, and Thomas continued his pursuits in Shoemaker. And then a few years later, we kind of grew up. He came to a school called St. Jerome's in Dundas. It was like a divinity college of some sort, or he was, and I remember his father signing him into the school and coming, and that's when we reconnected again. After he went to that to the school, I went to college and he went to Europe to get educated as well. And we haven't seen each other for, I don't know, maybe 15 years, 12 years, I really don't remember. And then in a typical Vukovic style, at 2:30, 3 o'clock in the morning, I receive a phone call from London, England. And a mutual friend, he says, I've got a guy here who says he knows you. And he doesn't want to tell me the name. He says they call him Glava, which means head. Now, I had forgotten the significance of that, but in any event, we hooked up through that phone call, and we met again at the Four Seasons in Toronto when he came. And that was when he was running with TransDominion in Calgary. And eventually, we were communicating all the time, meeting for dinners, became great friends. And the childhood friendship continued. I was always half his size, but I was a little bit older than him. And I was his protector, if you can imagine. Anyway, rekindled. Eventually, I followed him to Calgary when I had some issues with my dental career. And we started other businesses and so on and so forth. And then Emmanuel sent a little thing about music. And, you know, you could tell a million stories about Vukovic. I mean, thick and thin, we always had the greatest fun, the most joy one could ever have. And who could ever remember his little laugh, right? He would laugh like this church would ring with laughter when he laughed. Let me just refresh my mind here a bit. So the one story that came back to mind when Emmanuel sent the program, there was a song, many songs, but one in particular, a Croatian song called Pjevaj mi, pjevaj Sokole. And this is a sing, please sing, sing the falcon. And it is a very political song as well as a folklore song. And we were in a very famous old restaurant in Zagreb in 1991 of all years. I mean, Vukovic would not take me there during peace. He would take me there during war. So we were in this restaurant, and he ordered, and in Croatia, it's one of the things in restaurants and any place you have any kind of festivity, there's always music, always music. I love about that country. That's what I love about it. Anyway, he orders. The orchestra is playing, and he orders this song, Pjevaj mi, pjevaj Sokole. And I didn't understand it at the time. The war had just started in Yugoslavia. The tribalism was on a rise, and everybody wanted independence and so on. And this song was very inflammatory. So, being naive, we just enjoyed it, listened to the song. When the guy finished, all of a sudden there were two bottles of wine on our table, delivered from total strangers. So I said to Tom, what's this? He says, well, so he explained to me. He knew more. I was born there, he was born in Schumacher. But he knew more about Croatia, like he did about many other things, than most people. And he certainly knew more about it than I did. And we enjoyed that song, plus many others that they were kind of provocative. And then after we did that, we survived that, he and I went to Lika to visit his family. And I did most of the driving, and I got very, very tired because we just came off a flight. So he took over the car. All of a sudden, I wake up, he's shaking me, I look up, and there's a, I don't know if you know the hammer and sickle symbol in the old Yugoslavia. All sorts of people with beards, black vests, walking around. And he had driven us into a Serbian village in Lika. So he just took a turn to the left, and we made it through that. And then we were driving down the side of the road, and we saw he was going to ask somebody about directions, and was one of his relatives. So things like this happen with Thomas all the time. He's the most unbelievable person in that respect that you could ever meet. Anyway, I'm not going to keep this very long. I would like to now try suffer in Croatian. And apparently there's video viewing from Croatia and so on, and people who understand Croatian. So I will switch over, and you'll have to excuse me for not understanding if you don't. Tomica Vukovic, nije samo bio veliki čovjek, on je zbilja bio veliki čovjek. Uvijek je bio za Hrvatsku, uvijek je bio za sve ljude koji su trebali pomoći. Velikodušan, this magnanimous Thomas, has more significance in Croatian than probably in any other language. He's multilingual, like 4, 5, 6 languages, whatever he spoke. He always surprised me with a new one. And we have had tremendous times, sad times, whatever, hunting, fishing, whatever we did. We did many, many things together. Magnanimous Thomas, velikodušan Thomas, ja bi ga uvijek volio tako ga zapamtiti. What I've just said in Croatian is magnanimous Thomas is the way I want to remember him, and end my speech with that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Bill. I would like to welcome also everyone that is watching this around the world. My father knew many, many people all over the world. Thank you for joining us, wherever you are. And now, from the Vukovich family, from Prince George, living in Victoria, Rose Vukovich, my cousin.
Bill, thank you for speaking in Croatian so I don't have to, because mine's very bad. It will be better later in the afternoon once I've had some šljivovica, the Croatian brandy. So then I'll be very fluent, but right now I'll just say hvala svima što ste došle, and that's all I got. Thank you everyone for coming, both in person and online. Tomica in my family, we call him by his Croatian name, is my uncle. So he, my grandfather and Emmanuel's grandfather, the brothers, and so Tomica and my dad are first cousins. My parents couldn't be here today. Both had surgeries that they couldn't reschedule, so they've sent my sister and I here to represent. My dad wrote something that I'll read for everyone, but just to say, Tomica was, as Bill said, you know, he fills every room that he is in. For us, imagine having Tomica as your uncle. It was just the best thing in the whole world. He treated you, you know, as the most special person in the world. Didn't matter if you were small or big. He cared about what you had to say. He made you feel just like the sun was shining on you all the time. I've recently moved back to Canada. I've been in the US for 15 years. I can't believe that I didn't get a chance to see him here. It was top of my list, was I've got to come to Toronto and see Tomica. I can't believe that. This is the reason I'm here, but I feel very grateful to be here with all of you who have known him and love him as much as we do in our family. My sister and I can't wait to speak to folks throughout the rest of the day to hear about all the ways that Tomica made your life better as well. So thank you for being here. I'm going to pull out my phone and read what my dad wrote. Gave him a deadline. He had to give it to me by midnight last night. He made the deadline barely. Okay, this is from written by my dad. Tomica was a legend to me before I ever met him.
Growing up, I knew of my older cousin in Canada through the outgrown clothes and shoes Strina Roja, Tomic's mom, sent me twice a year to Croatia. I couldn't wait to meet him. I finally had the opportunity Christmas 1969 in Schumacher. Tomica was 21 and I was 20. He exceeded all of my expectations and then some. Even then, Tomica was larger than life, had tons of friends, and all the girls fell over him. 2 weeks went by very quickly, and we stayed in steady contact ever since. And those were the days before cell phones and emails and cheap long-distance plans. Through the years and places he lived, it mattered to Tomica that our families knew each other. He made a plan, and he made it happen. In his younger years, Tomica was fit and athletic. He claimed that he could outskate Peter Mahavlic, is that how you say it? The Croatians, who also lived in Schumacher. I never doubted him on that. In the late 90s, I convinced Tomica to walk 12 kilometers through a deep forest in northern BC, no trails or paths, to find a friend's cabin. He was gung-ho until I told him we would be trailblazing through bear country. He reluctantly agreed to carry a rifle. Well, on the way back, we didn't see bears, but he shot 7 grouse, which he prepared when we returned to the cabin, much to the delight of my friends, who were convinced he was a professional chef. Tomica made the mundane extraordinary. At my cabin, Tomica would get up at 6 a.m., strip down naked, and hoot and holler the whole way into the freezing lake, putting on a performance for anyone within earshot. He was legendary for many of my friends before they met him, too. That's Tomica, always adventurous, always eager to entertain, and always memorable. I'm going to miss him immensely, especially his weekly jokes that I'm not sure I ever fully heard because he falls into those fits of hysterical laughter that we all know and love before he ever gets to the punchline. I know he's making people laugh wherever he is, just like I know that he has bound all of us here that he's left behind with an appreciation for a good Tomica story. I bet collectively we can finally put together one of his jokes from start to finish. But even then, the best part will not be the punchline, but in learning the many ways he has made us laugh and love over the years. I love you, cousin. I love you, cousin. Rest in peace.
Thank you, Rose. Pierre Gauthier from Montreal.
Thanks for being here. I had to be here. Hello, everyone. Yesterday was my son's birthday. He was 38 years old. And thinking back to when he was born, at 3 o'clock in the morning, I had known Tom at that time, just gotten to know him. And he showed up at 3:30 in the morning with a bottle of champagne in the hospital. Who would do that? Celebration of life, that's what he was all about, you know? And, you know, for years, for the last, just made me realize that we've been soulmates for 40 years, doing business, telling jokes, and participating in his life and always traveled the planet and had an amazing time. He was always competitive. I can remember playing squash with him, and I was having a good day, and he was having a bad day. And I was leading 8-0 in a 9-point game. And when we came back to the locker room, the whistle stopped the game, and somebody asked who was winning. He said, well, nobody. The game wasn't finished, you know? So that was Tom's attitude in life. But, you know, about the laughter, let me take you to a flight we were on. I can't remember where. We did so many around the planet, but, you know, as the plane takes off and everything's really quiet in the room, then I lean over in his ear and I say, knock, knock. And he says, who's there? And I said, Gestapo. And he said, Gestapo who? And I said, I'm the one that's asking the questions. And for him, that must have hit a nerve. And he started laughing you know, from Eastern Europe and his background, I don't know, but that meant really something special to him. And he started laughing like for 5 minutes. And when I turned around, there were 300 people cracking up that couldn't stop laughing on the plane along with Tom. I mean, it was just incredible how that happened, you know? And so that's, you know, somebody said, yeah, if he were here, he'd fill any room with his laughter. But that was really quite remarkable as an example of the times we spent together. I'd come to Toronto here every couple of weeks, and my first stop was always in his office, and we'd recollect, just compare the things we were doing and see how we could help each other and so on. So, but it was always, when I was depressed, I'd just call him up and tell him a joke just so I could hear him laugh. And so that was a big part of how we did things together, you know. And of course, his business life, you know, from power plants in Central America to oil in Calgary, mining in Ontario, real estate in Europe, you know, he was a visionary and a real deal maker all the way through. But behind that is the character and who he really was. And why he was doing all this. And we used to talk about living on the edge. And he and I shared that space, and we really understood what it meant. And living outside your comfort zone. And that's where real growth happens. And we both understood that really well in the things we were doing, and perhaps that's why we were so compatible over time. He often compared business, you know, to being in the ring. And the obstacles, the victories, the challenges, and so on. And so we spent a lot of time in the ring together over the years. And every meeting I think I had with him was a celebration, and everything was electric all the time. And we you know, we shared that common space. And you know, they say that, you know, the destiny is the journey in life. And I was really blessed to be part of Thomas's journey over 40 years in business with our families and so on. I remember he met about playing the violin in my house when he was 7 years old in Montreal. So we covered all bases on all of that. And I can remember every time I left Thomas from a visit in Toronto here or elsewhere, he would look at me straight in the eye and shake my hand and say, "Never surrender." Some of you must have heard that. And so really on his behalf, whatever that means to you, and as a tribute to him, I tell you, never surrender. And I was totally blessed to have him in my life, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to talk a bit about Tom today. Appreciate it.
Thank you, Pierre. My sister, Anna-Sophia.
My dad. I'm gonna start crying, so bear with me. My dad loved the rain. He always remarked after a rainfall how happy he was that the earth and trees had been watered. It felt as if he was part of the earth and the rain had just quenched his thirst. During the first lockdown of COVID, I lived with my parents. When spring came, my dad would get up in the morning and go outside to water the garden. I would watch him stand there with the hose slowly watering the grass, the flowers and the trees. He especially liked trees and gave them extra attention. He planted trees in the various backyards we had, and even if they were about to die, he wanted them to be watered. He was very aware of them, and he felt happy when they were strong. Trees gave him a sense of protection, a sense of comfort, and he connected with their presence. My dad liked the mornings. He liked his cafe au lait, toast with butter and jam, or porridge with milk. Mornings were when his mind was the sharpest, when he blasted emails around the world, when his attention was on. My dad didn't understand the modern term boundaries. He called when he wanted, and he always wanted to be connected. He regularly called us all from his car, driving down to the office, leaving messages like, "Good morning, my darling. This is Papa. It's a beautiful day outside. I feel fantastic." He loved tapping in with people via his phone. It was his antenna, his tentacle, and he used it well. My dad was continuously making and talking deals. Deals on vacation, deals in the car, deals during dinner, and deals at the bar. He loved connecting with his business community, sharing, laughing, shouting, winning, and losing. He shared his love of classical music with us. On weekends, we would drive early to my aunt and uncle's place or to the Croatian land. Back then, Calgary was a tiny city and the roads were mostly empty in the mornings. He would put in the Horowitz and Moscow CD or some CD of Glenn Gould and drive slowly, thinking and looking. He loved Nigel Kennedy, and he particularly liked his recording of the Brahms Violin Concerto. He loved that he was a bad boy in classical music who could also play so well. His recording of the Brahms Violin Concerto was a very pure, unembellished, and spectacular performance of this piece. My dad believed in dreams. He supported our visions, and I watched the destiny between my brother and my dad unfold over the years. My brother was the driver and my dad the car, and they both shared a dream. He kept believing, supporting, watching, observing, intensely critiquing. He had extremely high standards, and he also understood that mistakes in music or playing perfectly is actually not what matters. Rather, the notes are a vehicle, and it is intention, ideation, interpretation, which makes a piece come alive. My dad believed in art, and he too supported my journey. He never questioned my intention when I transferred from a general arts degree at Dalhousie University to the Nova Scotia College of Art and Design. He joined me when I interviewed at the School of Art Institute in Chicago for their grad program. It was there at the Museum of Contemporary Art that he fell in love with the mobiles of Alexander Calder. He was amazed at how fresh they were and that they were made in the 1930s. On a very deep, intuitive level, he understood that art takes time, patience, space, and a sense of freedom to create, that it can't happen on demand. When I had been hustling to make ends meet and was exhausted in New York, he would say to me, "I think it's time you go on a residency," with a twinkle in his eye. For those who don't know, an art residency is essentially time and space to make work. It could be seen as a holiday, and he knew from the several residencies I had been on that they were loads of fun. People, parties, no deadlines, freedom. But he also knew that at their essence, they are invaluable and provide an opportunity to sink into your work on a level that is extremely hard to do in daily life. One of his most touching gestures was after my most recent show in New York. He was moved by the installation and took it upon himself to write a review, a response to it. It was obviously not from an art critic perspective, however, I was amazed at his perception of my intention behind the pieces. He cared, he was curious, and he was a big cheerleader of mine. He believed that art was essential to humanity, and he wholeheartedly supported our careers, knowing full well that they are financially unstable. My dad wanted a lot from life, and a lot of life, and he definitely leaned in. He loved turning up the voltage of an experience and letting it rip, so to say. He once told me that drinking wine was a religious experience for him. He wanted transcendence, a feeling of awe. I think he would have loved to shred on a guitar if he knew how. My dad liked being the center of attention, and he was good at it too. He liked telling jokes. He loved laughing, and he liked holding center court. Whenever I met someone new, he would ask me jokingly, "Did you tell them about my dad?" Of course I didn't, and he knew this, and this was one of our shared jokes. The Kootenays were a geography that was close to his heart, the lakes, the mountains, the grizzly bears, and the immense nature that makes you feel small. He sensed the increasing pollution of our world and gravitated towards the wild. He felt at home in a wooded area of pine trees, the wind rushing through and the sound of a fresh creek. He hiked as if he were a Boy Scout, a whistle, a knife, a little handkerchief around his neck, very heavy hiking boots, and always a stick he had whittled. My dad believed in sleep, and he could sleep anywhere. He would go into a kind of trance, which allowed him to be open to ideas. He was a conduit, and he knew how to tap into other ways of knowing, and ideas flowed to him. For the longest time, I believed that many of his ideas were going to become reality. However, I eventually learned this was just who he was. He was connected in this way to a powerful, vibrating source of energy, and he knew this was infinite. Before he died, he mentioned an idea of opening up a bookstore type gallery in Thornbury called Tommy's Reading Room. It was a way for him to keep his books and yet have them be accessible to the public. He knew he had to downsize. Sorry. My dad liked when the laundry was ironed, when the car was washed, when the logs were stacked, when the leaves were raked, when the house was cleaned, when the laundry dried in the sun, when the bills were paid, when things were done properly. He was extremely demanding, difficult, and particular, and the three of us swirled around him. The salad dressing had to be just so, the cheese wrapped just so, the garden hose put away just so, the pots cleaned just so, and so on. There was no middle ground, and his emotional pendulum swung from side to side. He once told me that his father, Anton, made him turn wood every Sunday in their basement in Schumacher so that the planks didn't warp. He grew up close to the reality of survival, and he felt that things could change in an instant. His father escaped Yugoslavia so that he could have socks and didn't need to warm his feet in manure during winters. My dad was always on the lookout, a lone wolf watching at night. My dad thrived in high-pressure situations where he needed to focus and think creatively. He liked when things got real, when circumstances and options became slim, as this is when his genius kicked in. He could think outside of the box, see avenues and possibilities, and intuit pathways. He loved his eau de toilette. However, he also loved when shit hit the fan. The rodeo was on and he was amped. My dad cultivated beauty. He bought objects that held meaning, history, and that were one of a kind. He once gifted me an old paddle that was used by explorers. Not a paddle to be used for a summer canoe trip, but an object to look at, to contemplate your existence with, and have a concrete, tangible experience of history and time. He bought tulips, yellow, pink, or red, and placed them in a crystal vase on the kitchen table. He loved Scandinavian architecture, and he wanted to go to Japan to see how their structures and spaces are created without the use of nails. Fine, refined, delicate, detailed, highly crafted things that made your mind ping-pong from the micro to the macro. He gave us an education through objects and experiences. My dad loved making fish soups and meat stews. This was an ever-evolving creation which became more refined over time. His first soups were bland and watery, and as the years passed, he developed their depth and flavor to something that really was quite exceptional. He was proud of his own cooking, and this was an avenue where his creativity grew. He was a master of sauces, and he taught me that a good sauce needs alcohol, something to cut the fat, to elevate the taste and create complexity. While he wanted and searched for the best foods, he ultimately knew that feeding people was not just about taste or satiating hunger. It was about communion, about making you feel not alone, and about making you feel safe on a very primal level. His last beef stew was made this Sunday before he died. For my mom, as she had just gotten out of the hospital. He made it in Markham, transported it in his car down to my apartment where my mom, my dad, and I ate it together around my kitchen table. He struggled walking but said everything was just fine. He was so pleased with himself because he didn't add any salt. No salt would have been the next chapter of my dad's cooking. My dad managed to participate in the mystery of life rather than try to solve or understand it. He knew that he was lucky to be alive. He swam with the river and he believed in destiny and the crossing of paths in each other's lives. On several occasions, he would say to me how happy he was that we had crossed paths in this lifetime. I was Daddy's girl and he was my dad. My teacher of intuition, of beauty, of paying attention to the details, a provider of rich sensory experience, of tremendous unwavering support in our creative endeavors and of dreaming large. Octavia Butler writes, "All that you touch, you change. All that you change, changes you. The only lasting truth is change. God is change." Thank you all for being here. Like the trees he so loved, I know he was quietly watching us and is in peace. Thank you.
What? We can ask Mama to come. Thank you, Anna-Sophia. We'd like to ask our mother, Heidi, to come up, and maybe if Maggie and Rose can help her.
Shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, so I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Please stand as we offer a prayer. I pray that Thomas Richard does dwell in the house of the Lord forever. O God of grace and glory, we come here to remember before you this day our brother Thomas Richard, to thank you for giving him to us, his wife and children, his family and friends to know and to love as a companion on our earthly pilgrimage. We thank you for the love and laughter he gave and received. In your boundless compassion, console us who miss him and who mourn. O God, your mercies cannot be numbered. Accept our prayers, our thankfulness on behalf of your servant Thomas, and grant him an entrance into the land of light and joy in the fellowship of all your saints, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Holy and gracious God, we entrust all who are near and dear to us to your never-failing care and love, not only for this life, but for the life to come, knowing that you are doing for them better things than we can ever desire or imagine or pray for, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant, with your saints where sorrow and pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your beloved son, Thomas Richard. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of God's saints in light. Amen. And may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus Christ, the great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant, make us strong in every good work to do his will, working in us that which is well-pleasing in his sight. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you all for coming this afternoon to celebrate and remember our father. My mother and sister and I will now carry his ashes out, and we welcome you and ask you all to join us in the reception in the next room at the end of this song. Thank you, and God bless all of you.